finally I get to say Happy Sabbath.
Yes. Happy Sabbath.
I'm like Brother Thomas, every time I get up here I was wanting to say Happy Sabbath. But I finally get to say it.
Amen.
I want to begin with a word of prayer for all those who are able, if you would kneel with me. Father, I pray that as we look at your word of life, your word of peace and safety, I pray that you will fill us with your Spirit, that you will guide our minds to truths that you would have us to know and understand, truths that will draw us closer to you through your Son. And Father, I pray that you will take these truths and you will take them from a head knowledge, and that you will take them and put them into a heart knowledge, that they will change our lives from the inside out, not just be an intellectual understanding, but a changed life. And so, Father, I thank you for answering this prayer, because I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We've been looking at the three angels' messages from a little different perspective than what most people go through. And I pray that perspective has opened some eyes to understanding, to having a greater understanding of what those three angels' messages entail, to the point that we're not just pointing fingers elsewhere at everyone else. And just as a brief recap, I know I see a lot of new faces here. We find that the first angel says that we are to worship God. And if we don't worship God, if we don't know who God is, we can't worship Him. Does that make sense?
Amen.
So we have to know who God is. And if we don't know who God is, if we're not worshiping the true God of heaven, then we fall into a backslidden state, which is condemned by the second angel's message, Babylon is fallen. So again, if we don't know who God is, and we're not worshiping the true God of the Bible, then we as an individual, we as a corporate group, whatever it is, slide naturally into the second angel's message of Babylon has fallen. And if we stay in that state, which Babylon has fallen says, do not worship God with a false concept of who He is. If you're worshiping God with a false concept of who He is, then you are a part of Babylon fallen. And if we stay in that state, and we do not adhere to or recognize the first angel's message, which is the gospel, the everlasting gospel, then we will then slide further into the third angel's message. And we will take on the very character trait of the beast power. And as we saw in the third angel's message, that is exactly what's going on. And it's not just with other Protestant denominations. What we find is that is also primarily with the Seventh-day Adventist corporate system. It has taken on the beast power character pretty much more so than any other Protestant denomination at this point. So when it started backsliding, it went quickly. And friends, that's because we're coming to the end quickly. And we need to recognize that we are coming to that end quickly and start to act. We've got to start acting. So the fourth angel, when you've rejected the first angel, you've come into the position where you're in the second angel, under the condemnation of the second angel, and you stay there, you eventually slide into the third angel's position, and when you're there, that's when the fourth angel starts to apply. And everybody know what the fourth angel is? Come out of her, my people. Heard that? You know, if you go to look this up in Ellen White's writings, you don't find a whole lot of hits on the fourth angel. But you find a lot under pseudonames or different names. Not false names, not pseudonames, but different names. And these are some of the names. I want to go over some of the different names that you will find it under. One name is the Cry of Elijah, or Elijah's Message. Now, you know about the three Elijahs? Everybody know about the three Elijahs? Anybody who doesn't have not heard of the three Elijahs? Okay. The three Elijahs, the first Elijah obviously was Elijah, right? So I have a question. Who did he pronounce his message to? Israel. Who was Israel? God's people, right? The remnant, the professed remnant. Elijah, the first Elijah, went to the professed remnant. He didn't go to the world. He went to the professed remnant. And what did he do? He went and he proclaimed a message. And that message was rejected, wasn't it? The king didn't want anything to do with it. He thought Elijah was some kook. He didn't want anything to do with it. It was rejected. So Elijah goes into the wilderness for a while, doesn't he? And while Elijah's in the wilderness, there is no rain. And then Elijah came back and there was a confrontation. And then there was rain. And so it is with us, with the fourth angel's message, friends. I believe the second Elijah was John the Baptist. And the third Elijah is us, right? It's the remnant, the 144,000. The different names for it, which we're going to go over. But the third Elijah proclaims a message. And if we look in history, I believe that the third Elijah has already come. I believe the third Elijah came forth and proclaimed a message in 1888. And that message was rejected. And since then, that third Elijah has been in the wilderness, and there has been how much rain? No rain. We look around and we see, why is nothing happening? Why are we not growing? It's because there's been no rain, because Elijah's been in the wilderness. But friends, I believe if we listen very closely, I believe we can hear his footsteps coming right now. I believe that there is about to be a confrontation, and then the latter rain will fully fall at that point. So this is oftentimes called the Elijah message, or as our ministry is called, the cry of Elijah. This is also called the latter rain message. You can find it under her writings when she's talking about the latter rain. She will refer to it as the latter rain message and things like that connected to the latter rain. And again, if we've looked in history, did not the latter rain start to sprinkle around 1888? It did, didn't it? But it was rejected. And so the latter rain is starting to sprinkle again now. We can hear Elijah coming back. We can hear his footsteps if we listen closely. This is also called the message of the 144,000. And, you know, this message has changed. I had one thing planned, and then after presenting the second and third angel's message and talking to different people and hearing conversation, I've tailored this one a bit more. And I was going to talk about the 144,000, but, you know, I don't believe the 144,000 is a fundamental principle. It's not something we should divide over. And so the 144,000 is also, therefore, something I don't want to put forth and confuse. Does that make sense? So I'm going to leave that alone until we can come into some sort of unity on that subject or some sort of agreement, and then I will preach it all the way. But this is dealing, this is called the message of the 144,000. This is the message that the 144,000 give. And what I want to do is look at Revelation 15 real quick. I want to draw something out that I found to be very interesting. Revelation chapter 15 and verse 3. And this is speaking of the 144,000. It says, they sing the song of Moses the servant of God and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. If we continue to look at the 144,000 in this song, we find that only the 144,000 can sing this song. Why? Why is it only the 144,000? It's their experience. It's not that they can't learn the song. It's not that other people can't learn the words and the tune. It's because the song is about their experience. And even the angels have to fold their wings because they cannot sing this song either. So I want to look at Deuteronomy chapter 32. There's other places, you know, that very well could be the Song of Moses. But I found this very interesting when I was looking at this. And I started reading Deuteronomy 32, and all of a sudden things really started to come to life. Deuteronomy 31 verse 30 says, "And Moses spoke in the ears of the congregation of Israel the words of this song until they were ended." So I want to go through, I don't have time to read through the whole chapter, but as I'm going to read through the first probably half of the chapter, but keep in mind something very interesting, this layout from verses 8 to 14. From 8 to 14, I believe is speaking about the Philadelphian church. And then from 15 on a ways until about 42, 43, it talks more of another system. Laodicea, not just Laodicea. But kind of keep that in mind. Chapter 32, verse 1, "Give ear, O ye heavens, and I will speak, and hear, O earth, the words of my mouth." Many people are very familiar with this next verse. "My doctrine shall drop as the rain, my speech shall distill the dew, as the dew, as the small rain upon the tender herb, and as the showers upon the grass. Because I will publish the name of the Lord, ascribe ye greatness unto our God. He is the rock, his work is perfect, for all his ways are judgment, a God of truth and without iniquity, just and right is he. They have corrupted themselves. Their spot is not the spot of his children. They are a perverse and crooked generation." So here God is talking about a group of people that have corrupted themselves. And they are perverse and a crooked generation. And they're not his children. That's something to keep in mind. "Do ye thus requite," verse 6, "the Lord, O foolish people and unwise? Is not he thy father that has bought thee? Has he not made thee and established thee? Remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father, and he will show thee. Thy elders, and they will tell thee." Within the Advent movement, who would our elders be?
Pioneers,
right? So do you think we should ask them some things about the movement and about truth? Absolutely. Verse 8 starts to talk about the pioneers. "When the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land, in the waste, howling wilderness. He led him about. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye." Who was instructed? The pioneers, right? Who instructed the pioneers?
God.
God instructed the pioneers. "As an eagle stirs up her nest, flutters over her young, spreads abroad her wings, takes them, bears them on her wings, so the Lord alone did lead him. And there was no" what? "There was no strange God with him." Friends, this is important. We're going to see this over and over and over through these couple of verses. The Philadelphian church had no strange God. "He made him ride on the high places of the earth, that he might eat the increase of the fields. And he made him to suck honey out of the rock, and oil out of the flinty rock. Butter of kine and milk of sheep, with fat of lambs and rams, of the breed of Bashan. and goats with the fat of kidneys of wheat, and thou didst eat or drink the pure blood of the grape. So this ends talking about the Philadelphian church, the pioneers. And now it starts talking about another group of people that came after them. But Jeshurun waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxen fat. Thou art grown thick. Thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. Can you see some parallels there? Can you see how that's happened in our past history? How there was a group of people that worshipped the one true God, and God made them to ride upon the high places, and he himself taught them. But then something happens. A time comes when they no longer worship this God. They lightly esteem, they forsook God, and then they lightly esteem the rock of his salvation. Who's the rock of his salvation?
The Son of God.
The Son of God. Verse 16, they provoked him to jealousy with what kind of gods?
Strange
gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed unto devils and not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not, whom the pioneers feared not. A whole nother God has arisen. And this is not the same God of the pioneers.
Right.
Friends, we tend to think, well, yeah, there's some differences, but it's really the same God.
Yeah.
That's not what the Bible says.
Well, verse tells us that God's upset about it.
Yeah, as Pastor pointed out, this is telling us that God is upset about this. Should we be upset?
That's right.
Amen. Verse 18, of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful, and hast forgotten God that formed thee. And when the Lord saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide mine face from them. I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very froward generation. Children in whom is no faith. Do you think there's righteousness by faith here? There is no righteousness by faith. You cannot have righteousness by faith if you don't know who God is. If you're worshiping a false God, then you only have the faith or the righteousness of that false God. And it is not the true righteousness. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities, and will move them, and I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. That is very interesting. That is very interesting. I wish I had some time to go into that. But God provokes with a foolish nation. Elijah, when he was in the wilderness for those years, who did he stay with? A widow. Was she a Jewish widow? No, she was a Gentile, wasn't she? Elijah stayed with a Gentile woman. Friends, if we look about now, God has been giving the Spirit to other churches. There have been other churches that are proclaiming the health message because we've not been doing it. There are other churches that have been proclaiming the Sabbath because we've not been doing it. There is even another church that has been proclaiming the sanctuary. Now, she's got some things wrong, but she's been doing a better job than any Seventh-day Adventist system has been by long shots. He's been provoking with foolish nations. For a fire is kindled in mine anger, and I shall burn unto the lowest hell, and shall consume the earth with her increase, and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. I will heap mischief upon them. I will spend mine arrows upon them. They shall be burnt with hunger and devoured with burning heat. That's a reference to the plagues. And with bitter destruction, I will also send the teeth of beasts upon them with the poison of serpents of the dust. Verse 25 is very interesting. The sword without and terror within shall destroy both the young man and the virgin, the suckling also with the man of gray hairs. You know, the pioneers, A.T. Jones and then some others, predicted that the final war was going to be between the U.S. and Russia. And I believe that the sword without there is probably Russia. And you know what's interesting is they predicted that the key to the whole debate was going to be Crimea. Do you know that? They predicted this many, many years ago.
What? I didn't hear that.
Crimea was going to be the spark that started the heat between Russia and the U.S. And terror from within. Well, who would that be? Don't we have terrorism going on? That terrorism is going to move closer and closer home to us. I want to jump to verse 31. I just really want to go through the whole chapter and comment, but verse 31, for their rock is not as our rock, even our enemies themselves being judges. So this is what the 144,000 go through. The 144,000 come out of a system that the 144,000, their forefathers, if you will, worship the true God. They had sound fundamental doctrine. Did they have some error? Yeah. But their fundamentals were correct. And so the 144,000 see that. They come out of false systems. And they come out of this system that worships a false god. And this is their song. This is their experience. This is what they're talking about. For their rock is not as our rock, is what the 144,000 says. They worship someone else. 2 Corinthians 11:4. Does anybody know what that is off the top of their head? I'm talking about another Jesus?
Another gospel, another spirit, and another Jesus.
Yes, another gospel, another spirit, and another Jesus. Paul is warning us that there is another Jesus. You know, I believe, friends, that that's a prophecy. I believe he was telling us. The prophets spoke more for our time than they did for their own. I believe Paul was telling us that there was going to be another Jesus. Of course, there was some of that going on then. For their rock is not as our rock, even our enemies themselves being judges. Other religions can look at us and tell that we don't worship the same God. Does that make sense? You see that there? And I just don't have time. That is a very interesting study.
Can I just ask a quick question, Matt?
Yes.
In the part in verse 31, it says, our enemies themselves being judges. Does that mean the people outside of those groups are judging and telling them what they must believe and what they are to do? Or do you have an idea on that?
What I see that as saying is that they look and they see us compared to other religions, and they judge that we do worship a totally different God. They're judging that the God is totally different, or the rock. 31. Yeah. Chapter 32.
Yeah, 32.
Yeah.
And what verse again?
31. That was verse 31. And there's a lot. He keeps going on. But ultimately, this is the 144,000. And ultimately, what this means is that the 144,000 come out of false systems of worship. Can you see that there in Deuteronomy 32? Can you see that? I'm starting to get some blank stares. Am I losing people? Do people understand where I'm coming from?
Yes.
Well, all of chapter 32.
All of the Song of Moses.
Yes, all of the Song of Moses.
Right.
You know, this is also called the loud cry of the third angel. So the fourth angel, if you look it up, it's called the fourth, it's called The Cry of Elijah, The Latter Rain Message, The Message of the 144,000, The Loud Cry of the Third Angel. Actually, and I missed one.
Midnight Cry?
Pardon?
Midnight Cry?
To an extent, yes. Yes, it is to be repeated. I've missed something that is not in my notes, so you can just leave that there. You know, it's called The Fourth Angel. And if you look up The Fourth Angel, what you will find is Ellen White says, you cannot call the Seventh-day Adventist Church Babylon. Has anybody ever heard that statement? You know what that boils down to? Friends, there is a stipulation. If you look at what she says, she provides a stipulation. And she says God's commandment-keeping people cannot be called Babylon. Right. We get so hung up on the fourth commandment. You know, James says, if you've broken one, you've broken them all. But Adventists say, if you keep the fourth, you keep them all. That is the mentality that we tend to have. If we keep the fourth, we've got them all. Isn't that right? Yeah. Isn't that the typical mentality that we have? Friends, that's not the case. She says God's commandment-keeping people can't be called Babylon. You know that includes the first commandment?
You really can't keep the fourth if you don't understand the first.
Yes. Thank you. He said you really can't keep the fourth if you don't understand the first.
Right, yeah.
And that's where that boils out in the first angel's message. What's more important, the Sabbath or the God of the Sabbath? And ultimately, you can worship on the right day, but if you're not worshiping the right God, you've got nothing going for you. So you need to know who the God of the Sabbath is first. But the first commandment is, I am the Lord thy God that brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And friends, if we're worshiping some other god, then we're not a commandment keeper, are we? If I'm not worshiping the true God of heaven and I'm worshiping another god, can the term Babylon fallen be applied to me? Yes. Absolutely. 110%. Now, what if I call myself a Seventh-day Adventist? Can the term Babylon fallen still be applied to me if I'm worshiping a false god? Absolutely, because I'm not keeping the commandments. It is God's commandment-keeping people that can't be called Babylon. And that's something that we have to understand. And so, you know, that's what you will find if you look up the fourth angel. It's kind of hard to find. It's in one of the selected messages where she talks about that, and I wanted to have that here, but ran out of time and I ran out of space too. But I'm going to talk a little more about what is a Seventh-day Adventist here in just a minute, because that is also important to understand. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 8. This is called the loud cry of the third angel. So let's look at Revelation chapter 14 and verse 8. Why Revelation 14, 8? That's the second angel. We're talking about the fourth angel, right? Well, I want to read the second angel first, and then I want to jump over to Revelation 18 and compare the two so that we can see the similarities. 14:8, the second message, or the second angel says, and there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now let's jump to Revelation 18:4. Or 1-3, sorry. Let's look at Revelation chapter 18, verses 1-3. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. Now notice, this first verse is not found anywhere with the first three angels. Now the first angel is said to have to cry aloud, but it says nothing of the power. So there's something about the fourth angel that has more power than the first three. Verse 2, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, is fallen. Sound familiar? Verbatim, the second angel. But something more is here, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. That is new information. That is not found in the second angel's message, right? So that's new information. Something has been added here. And then verse 3, for all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Sound familiar again? That's the second angel's message again. But then again, something else gets added. And the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. So friends, what we see is the fourth angel there reproclaims the second angel's message, but the fourth angel gives added information. Not a new message, but added information. We talk about the three angels' messages, but there are four angels, right? Why do we not talk about four angels? Because the fourth angel doesn't give a new message. You've got the first angel who comes along with a message, and then you've got the second angel who comes along with a different message, a distinct message, but it doesn't conflict. And then you've got the third angel who comes along with yet another message that is distinct, but doesn't conflict. And then you've got the fourth angel. The fourth angel doesn't have a new message. The fourth angel repeats the first three and adds power to the message, but adds a few things to this about the sins of Babylon that have come in. And I want to talk a little bit more about that. I want to read Daniel in Revelation, page 7:11, third paragraph. At what time, he's talking about Revelation 18, verses 1 to 3, at what time do these verses have their application? When may this movement be looked for? If the position here taken is correct, that these churches, this branch of Babylon, experienced a moral fall by the rejection of the first message of Revelation 14. Remember how I was saying that the first angel's message is the cure to the problems of the second and third angels. And if we reject the first angel, then we slip into the condition of the second. And if we stay in there, then we eventually slip into the condition of the third angel. I found that interesting when I was reading this. I was like, oh, he came to the same conclusion I did. And the announcement of the chapter under consideration could not have gone forth previous to that time. So in other words, Revelation 18:4, the fourth angel, couldn't have gone forth prior to the first angel. Does that make sense? Obviously it's the fourth angel, not the first. It is then either synchronous with the message or parallel with the message of the fall of Babylon, the second angel of 14, or it is given at a later period than that, but it cannot be synonymous. In other words, he's saying the fourth angel can go parallel to the second, but it's not the same thing, is what he's saying. For that merely announces, the second angel merely announces the fall of Babylon, while the fourth angel adds several particulars which at that time were neither fulfilled nor in process of fulfillment. As we are therefore to look this side of 1844, where the previous message went forth, for the announcement brought to view in this chapter, we inquire, has any such message been given from that time to the present? The answer must still be in the negative. Hence, this message is yet future. But friends, I think, again, if we listen closely, we can hear the footsteps of Elijah, and he's coming back. And he's about to proclaim this message with power. I think the latter rain has started to sprinkle. We're starting to feel some of the power now. So he's saying there that there was added information. The fourth angel adds some information about Babylon fallen. Now I have a question. If the three angels' messages have been proclaimed undiluted, have you ever heard that saying?
Yeah.
Proclaiming the undiluted three angels' messages? If the three angels' messages undiluted have been proclaimed to this day, then why would the fourth angel have anything to add?
Very good question.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
He wouldn't have anything to add, now would he? If the three angels' messages have been proclaimed to this point, the fourth angel would have no sins to point out other than that which has already been pointed out. So you know what that tells me? That tells me that the ball was dropped. The three angels' messages ceased being proclaimed. No matter how much we hear anybody say we are proclaiming the undiluted three angels' messages, obviously the messages must have ceased to be proclaimed. Otherwise, the fourth angel would have nothing to add. Nothing to add whatsoever. When was that ball dropped? I believe that ball was started to be fumbled. I'm not going to point out when it was dropped. That's up to whatever. But that ball clearly started to be fumbled in 1888. Can you see that? The third Elijah came and proclaimed a message. That message was rejected. You can't reject that message without starting to fumble that ball. And so what we then see is in this next... So the third angel of righteousness by faith was rejected. So the natural result then is the rejection of the second angel. And then after that, the first angel was rejected. Can you see that? So the Advent movement had accepted the first angel and proclaimed it. They had accepted the second angel and proclaimed it. They had accepted most of the third and proclaimed it, but the core, the group as a whole, rejected righteousness by faith. So then it started to backslide. They rejected the second angel until they rejected the first angel. And when they rejected the first angel, then the denunciations started to be proclaimed. The denunciation of the second angel started to apply. And then as time went on and they stayed in that condition, rather than adhering to the first angel's message and going back to the everlasting gospel, the third angel started to apply. And now, friends, I believe that the fourth angel applies. The fourth angel, or thus the fourth angel, the fourth angel cries aloud, "Come out of her, my people, that you receive not of her plagues." This isn't a small ordeal. You know, I when I started, for those of you who weren't here, and for those of you who were, I want to repeat this. I started by saying I wanted to give a message of peace and safety. Don't we all want to give that kind of a message? And I said, "Lord, I don't want to give this message." But I was impressed very strongly as I was thinking about this. There is peace and safety in the three angels' messages. There is peace and safety when we adhere to them. Then we have peace and safety.
Amen.
Friends, there is no peace and safety in receiving of her plagues. There can be no peace and safety there. But how will they know unless somebody preaches? And who is willing to preach? This is not a fun message. It's not an easy message. Not many people like to hear it, including us. A lot of us don't like to hear it. But it's a message that has to go forward. It must go forward. Revelation 18:4. "And I heard another voice from heaven saying, 'Come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, that you receive not of her plagues.'" Friends, that is, it's a pretty strong denunciation. It's a very strong denunciation. I'm going to talk a little bit about what is a Seventh-day Adventist, because this is where we start to get a little bit confused. We will say, oh yeah, yeah, I see that, but who was it I heard earlier talking about the word but? It was Brother Michael. Yeah. Talking about the word but. The word but means what you said just previous means nothing. I love you, but... You see how that works? I will do this, but... See how the word but there means what I just said absolutely means nothing. It was just a waste of air. And so that's what happens. We will say, we will look at this message and we will say, okay, I can agree with this, but you can't call Seventh-day Adventist Babylon. So I want to take just a few minutes and I want to try to continue to clarify this subject. What is a Seventh-day Adventist? Remember, we already briefly talked about this for just a moment. Seventh-day Adventists are commandment-keeping. That includes the first commandment. But I want to ask, how does God define what a Seventh-day Adventist is? And this is actually some sections that I've taken out of a DVD that I call I Am a Seventh-day Adventist. And that's an hour and 45 minutes, and I'm long-winded, but I'm not that long-winded. And everybody goes, whew. I'm long-winded, but not quite that. But I want to read... I want to go through several of these quotes and show what a Seventh-day Adventist really is. Because I want to really try to solidify this for us. Manuscript 13, 1889. Now at the present time, God designs a new and fresh impetus shall be given to His work. Satan sees this. Are we looking for a fresh and new impetus to be given to the work? Yes. Do you think God is? Yes. Satan sees this. So what is he trying to do? And he is determined it shall be hindered. He knows that if he can deceive the people who claim to believe present truth, who is that? Seventh-day Adventists. As a group, as a large, as a whole. And make them believe that the work the Lord designs to do for His people is removing the old landmarks, something which they should with most determined zeal resist. Then He exults over the deception He has led them to believe. In other words, let me put that in plainer English. That wasn't very well spoken, I think. Kind of jumped around, but God wants to put a fresh impetus upon the work. The devil sees it, he knows it, and he's trying to get us to believe that God wants us to do away with the old landmarks. That's what she said. The devil is trying to get us to believe God wants us to do away with the old landmarks. And doing away with the old landmarks is something we should resist with determined zeal.
Amen.
Determined zeal. But if he gets us to believe that God wants us to... A bunch of people jumped. Am I that scary? Have I got everybody that far on edge that when a book drops, everybody jumps? Asleep. Oh no. Laodicea. He exults over that deception if he gets us to believe that. The work for this time has certainly been a surprising work of various hindrances, hasn't it been? Owing to the false setting of matters before the minds of many people. So what I want to draw out of that is false setting of matters is the removing of old landmarks. And the removing of the old landmarks is the same thing as the false setting of matters before the minds of the people. Can you see that? The next one is Gospel Workers 308, paragraph 2. Perilous times are before us. Everyone who has a knowledge of the truth should awake and place himself... Did the book awake everybody? That's what this is to do, is to wake us up. To awake and place himself body, soul, and spirit under the discipline of God. Oh, you missed a perfect spot for an amen. That is what we need to do. Friends, the enemy is on our track. We must be wide awake on our guard against him. We must put on the whole armor of God. We must follow the directions given through the spirit of prophecy. We must love and obey the truth for this time. This will save us from accepting strong delusions. God has spoken to us through His Word. He has spoken to us through the testimonies to the church and through the books that have helped to make plain our present duty and position that we should now occupy. The warnings that have been given line upon line, precept upon precept, should be heeded. If we disregard them, what excuse can we offer? There's no excuse. I beseech those who are laboring for God not to accept the spurious for the genuine. Let not human reason be placed where divine, sanctifying truth should be. Christ is waiting to kindle faith and love in the hearts of His people. Let not erroneous theories receive countenance from the people who ought to be standing firm on the platform of eternal truth. So this platform of eternal truth, it goes a little ways and then it stops and changes.
No.
No. That wouldn't be platform of eternal truth then, would it? It would be a platform that has a start and then an end, and then it would be a different platform. God calls us to hold firmly to the fundamental principles that are based upon questionable authority? Unquestionable authority. So the fundamental principles are the genuine and all else is the spurious. Can you see that? So if something disagrees with the fundamental principles, then it is a spurious. Counsels to Writers 52, paragraph 2. As a people, we are to stand firm on the platform of eternal truth that has withstood test and trial. We are to hold to the sure pillars of our faith. The principles of truth that God has revealed to us are our only true foundation. Who is she speaking to? Is she speaking to the Pentecostals here?
No.
Who's she speaking to?
Seventh-day Adventists.
So what is a Seventh-day Adventist according to this so far? Those who stand on the true foundation. Can you see that there? So in other words, if you're not standing on the true foundation, are you a Seventh-day Adventist?
No.
But what if I say I'm a Seventh-day Adventist 100 times? Will that make it so?
I saw a bar named Paradise.
What's that?
I saw a bar named Paradise.
A bar named Paradise? Yeah. Yeah, that's not Paradise. No matter how many times you call it Paradise, a bar named Paradise isn't Paradise. Especially when you wake up in the morning. It's terrible. I don't know why people do that. They have made us what we are. So these fundamental principles, this firm foundation has made us what we are. The lapse of time has not lessened their value. You know, I've heard that one quite a few times too. Well, that was old. That was for them. That was old light. I've got new light. I want to read one more here. Counsels to Writers 31, paragraph 2. When the power of God testifies as to what is truth, that truth is to stand forever as the truth. And how many after suppositions?
No.
None. There are to be no after suppositions. Contrary to the light God has given are to be entertained. Men will arise with interpretations of Scripture which are to them truth, but which are not truth. The truth for this time God has given us as a foundation for our faith. He Himself has taught us what is truth, not the devil. One will arise and still another with new light, which contradicts the light that God has given under the demonstration of His Holy Spirit. Friends, I've heard this one too. Well, we've got new light. Ellen White, Sister White, says that we are to have new light. Is that true?
Yes.
But what they so happen to leave out is the simple fact that new light will not conflict with the light God has already given. And if it does conflict, it is not light at all, but darkness. So, let me read one more. This one, if I can find it here in my notes, I'd rather read it from my notes. We read this already in the second angel's message, but I want to read this again because I think this really starts to make things clear, and I hope it drives things home. First selected message is 204, paragraph 2. The enemy of souls has sought to bring in the supposition that a great reformation was to take place among Seventh-day Adventists. So they are throwing out this hype that this new theology is a good thing. We need to do this. This is a great reformation. And that this reformation would consist in giving up the doctrines which stand as the pillars of our faith and engaging in a process of reorganization. Were this reformation to take place, what would result? The principles of truth that God in His wisdom, not error, in His wisdom has given to the remnant church would be discarded. Our religion would be changed. Friends, you see that clearly? I hope that that makes that crystal clear, that when you step off the fundamental principles and you step onto another platform, it is not the same religion. It doesn't matter how many times you call it Seventh-day Adventist or anybody else calls it Seventh-day Adventist, it is not the same religion. Friends, we can't get hung up on the name. We tend to get hung up on that name. And we try to cling to a system that has got a name because we want to hang on to that name, but it is not the name that saves us. We get hung up on that name. Early Writings, 124, paragraph 3. This is pretty strong in light of what I've presented so far, in light of what I've brought forth. I was shown the necessity of those who believe that we are having the last message of mercy. Is that us? Being separate from those who are daily imbibing new errors. So are we to be separate from those who are imbibing new errors?
Yes.
Did she say, unless they call themselves Seventh-day Adventists?
No.
Did she say, unless they believe in the Godhead?
No.
You can't unite if you believe in the Godhead, but somebody else is still not standing on the fundamental principles. You still can't unite. Being separate from those who are daily imbibing new errors, I saw that neither young nor old should attend their meetings, for it is wrong to thus encourage them while they teach error that is a deadly poison to the soul and teach for doctrines the commandments of men. Friends, is the Trinity a deadly poison to the soul? Should we support that system?
No.
According to this, I'm not asking you according to me, I'm according to this. Should we support that?
No.
Can we support that?
No.
The influence of such gatherings is not good. If God has delivered us from such darkness and error, we should stand fast in the liberty wherewith He has set us free. Amen?
Yes.
And rejoice in the truth. Friends, God is displeased with us when we go to listen to error without being obliged to go. There is a time and a place to go. But you better be sure that God is called. You better be sure. For unless He sends us to those meetings where error is forced home to the people by the power of the will, he will not keep us. Friends, if we've not been called to go back, God will not keep us if we do. The angels cease their watchful care over us, and we are left to the buffetings of the enemy, to be darkened and weakened by him, and the power of his evil angels and the light around us becomes contaminated with the darkness. While false doctrines and dangerous errors are pressed upon the mind, it cannot be dwelling upon the truth, which is fit and to prepare the house of Israel to stand in the day of the Lord. That was actually another quote. That's why I prefer reading them off my notes, because I can see what's coming up. But friends, is that pretty clear? We're not to go where error is being taught. The teaching of a Trinity is a deadly heresy. Is it not?
It is, and it's not the only one.
And it's not the only one. That's just the one that I've touched on. There's a lot more. But friends, we can't go. We can't go back unless God has called us. Because if we go back, and God, when God hasn't called us, we are left to the buffetings of the devil. That's scary. That's serious. My heart, I can't express how serious this is. This is why this message must be given. I don't like to give it, but it must be given. It must be given. Volume 3, page 407. Okay. The Word of God is to be our defense when Satan works with such lying wonders that if it were possible, he would deceive the very elect. Remember this in Matthew 24, the deceiving of the very elect? If it were possible, he would deceive the very elect. It is then that those who have not stood firmly for the truth will unite with the unbelieving who love and make a lie. Did you catch that? Friends, it's not those who don't understand the truth that are in danger. It is those who do not stand firmly for the truth that are in danger. These are people that know the truth. They see the truth. They probably even understand the truth, but they're not standing firm. Friends, these are the people that are in danger. It is then that those who have not stood firmly for the truth will unite with the unbelieving who love and make a lie and shall receive of the plagues. She didn't say that, I'm saying that. When you unite and you form into that system, you will receive of her plagues. Does that make sense? When these wonders are performed, when the sick are healed and other marvels are wrought, they will be deceived. Are we prepared for the perilous times that are right upon us? Or are we standing where we will fall an easy prey to the wiles of the devil? Friends, there is a 1,000-foot cliff. Do we need to walk right beside that cliff? No. You don't want to walk beside that cliff. What happens if you trip and stumble? You might fall the wrong direction and you're gone. But if you get clear away from the cliff, you still don't want to trip and stumble. But if you do, you're not going off the cliff. Does that make sense? We want to stand where we will not fall an easy prey to the wiles of the devil. We want to stay as far away from that as possible. Does that make sense? Brother Elvis earlier said, there's a time to point fingers. And I'm going to point fingers. Earlier, when I started this, I said, I'm not pointing fingers elsewhere. I want to point fingers to me. But I'm going to start pointing fingers. And it's going to be at me, too. Primarily me. I want to read, and I'm pointing fingers at home now. This is what I want to drive home. We're a few minutes over here, so I want to make this brief. Daniel in Revelation, page 711, the paragraph just previous to what I read earlier.
Is that the first edition?
Yes, this is actually an original.
Okay.
The term Babylon, as applied to them, is not a term of reproach, but is simply expressive of the confusion and diversity of sentiment that exists among them. Friends, do we have that going on here? With us? I'm not pointing fingers at the professed Seventh-day Adventist Church now. I'm pointing fingers at us. Do we have that going on here? Yes, we do. Friends, all too often when I go to people, I present the Father and Son, I present the first angel's message to people, and then I present the second angel's message, and then the third, and then I call people out of Babylon. They tend to look around at the movement and they say, "You're calling me out of my organized religion into what? You guys are bickering among yourselves far more than we are." And that falls under this definition of Babylon, but is simply expressive of the confusion and diversity of the sentiment that exists among them. Friends, Brother Elvis was talking about pointing fingers, and not just pointing fingers like this, but like this. Well, I'm not pointing fingers at Pastor Allen. I'm not pointing fingers at the Aikens or at the Beaches. I'm not pointing fingers at Clayton or Natter, Mansoor. I am pointing fingers at each one of you. And I'm pointing fingers at me. And you might say, "But wait a minute. What did I do?" That's the point. What have we done? If we haven't stood up and said, "Wait, no, we need to fix this." If we haven't stood up, then I'm just as fault. I'm just as much at fault, if not more so, than anybody else. Does that make sense? All of a sudden, everybody's gotten quiet. Friends, I don't say this for the purpose of pointing fingers. I say this for the purpose, if we don't get our act together, we're not going home. In fact, I believe with my own whole heart that the children of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, they came to before the borders of the heavenly Canaan, of the earthly Canaan, but they refused to go in. So what happened is they had to wander in the wilderness for 40 years, and then they came back. And the second time was harder, but they did go in. Friends, I believe Sister White said that Jesus could have come ere now. That tells me we've already been to the border of the heavenly Canaan once. We've been wandering in the wilderness. Elijah came and proclaimed a message, and we've been wandering in the wilderness since then. We're coming back to that border now. But friends, I believe God's not going to wait for us. That's what I believe. I believe He's not going to wait. Just as Jesus said in His triumphal entry, when the Jews tried to make Him make everyone be quiet from singing Hosanna to the Son of David, He said, if they are to be quiet, the very rocks will cry out. Friends, I believe if we don't get our act together, we are going to be left out. I don't care what our theology is. We can have all the correct theology, but if we don't get our act together, we will be left out. The very rocks will cry out. Friends, a lot of people will come and say, when I call them out, they will say, "You, what are you calling me out to? There is just as much confusion going on there as there is where I'm at." No matter what church I'm calling them out of, they will say this, and I hear this a lot. This has been my number one frustration. This is why I'm presenting this. Is because we will not have power as a group. I will not have power until we as a group get things together. Does that make sense? I won't have that power. I can't have that power. And so my bid to those people is this. Speak up. If you look at us and you say, "Wow, boy, you've got a bunch of..." Just Babylon. You've got a bunch of confusion and disharmony going on. Don't stay where you're at. If you stay in that system, how much are you helping us? None. You're not helping us in the least bit by staying in a false system. Come out of that system and do something about it. If you don't like what you see, do something about it. Stand up. Lend your voice. You don't have to be a leader in this movement. You don't have to be somebody that everybody knows. You don't have to be somebody that when you search the BRI website, you find their name. You don't have to be there. You can be a nobody like me. Stand up. Lend your voice.
Amen.
That's what it takes. We all just have to stand up and lend our voice. In closing, I want to ask this question. Will you choose Jesus? Will you choose Christ? Will you choose His truth? Or will you choose a false system? See, friends, when you're choosing a false system, you're not choosing Christ. Does that make sense? You can't choose Christ if you choose a false system. You can't choose Christ if you choose Babylon Fallen. So my question to you is, will you choose Christ? Will you choose Jesus? That's a question I want each and every one to think about, to ponder. And if you're ready to make that commitment, I would ask that you would kneel with me in prayer, that you would choose Jesus. Father in heaven, we come before you humbly. Lord, we plead that you will fill us with your Spirit. We plead that you will lead us and guide us into truth. We plead that you will change our hearts, that you will draw us closer to you and make us more and more like you in character. And Lord, I plead for your movement. I plead for your people, that you will empower us, that we may come together, that we may be able to stand in unity on the fundamental principles that you have given in your wisdom. Lord, I pray that you will not pass us by, that you will not use the rocks to cry out, but that you will use us to cry out, that you will send that fourth angel with power and glory, and that we may lighten the whole world with this message. But Father, the only way this message is going to go to the whole world with power and glory is if we come together and work together. Lord, I pray that you will lead us and guide us in coming together. I pray that there are those who have made a commitment to come out of Babylon, Babylon fallen of the second angel. Father, I pray that you will be with them. And I pray that you will bring them into your true organization, that you will bring them into harmony, and that they will lend harmony to your movement. And that as they stand up, that more people will say, "What is happening?" and ask, why are you leaving? And that then will be a witness, an opportunity that we have to present the everlasting gospel. And so, Father, I ask that you will empower us, that you will give us courage to stand up, and that you will give us the words to speak to present the everlasting gospel to those around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Would you be pleased to have us sing?
Yes.
Amen.
We'd be glad to host a song for you. Not host. Sorry. Glad to sing a song for you guys. Sorry about that.
Amen. That's wonderful.
Almost persuaded now to believe, almost persuaded Christ to receive. Seems now some soul to say, "Go, Spirit, go thy way." Some more persuaded, doom comes at last. Almost cannot avail, almost is but to fail. Sad.